Hello everybody and welcome to this tutorial. Today we're going to do some pre-authentication exploitation whereby we will pull the credentials without actually authenticating with the router. We're not going to pull the router's credentials in this particular case. We're going to pull some information on the wireless. Now, there are some pretty interesting facts about this method and this approach. For example, I have seen it used. Well, I haven't actually seen it with my own eyes. I've just read about it on the net. And I've read the reports. So basically, here's what people did. Because there is a vulnerability within TP-Link routers that you can pull wireless log, wireless credentials, wireless login keys, provided, of course, that you have the external router IP address. And now that is the catch. So how do you get the IP address? When you are not authenticated with the service, I mean, there really is no easy way of doing it. So what some people came up with, I mean, this is clearly in the realm of illegal and you definitely shouldn't do this. I mean, it's very unlikely that you will get a permission to do this. But you know, rules vary from one ISP provider to another. And they did the following. They basically conducted a full wide scan of all the IP addresses within one country. And they've basically, there's a, because Nmap supports scripting, you see some of those scripts in front of me. I'm going to clear the screen because I want to show you how to install them. Because Nmap supports scripting, it has allowed them to run one single automated command and just let it run there. And it didn't run for even that long. It ran for maybe a couple of, well, not a couple of hours, but it ran for a day for sure, something of a kind. And it scanned one IP address after another. And if it would confirm that the IP address was vulnerable, that the services running on that IP address were actually vulnerable, they would be exploited immediately by Nmap scripts and credentials would be pulled. So these scripts ran for about a day or so. They had a massive amount of wireless passwords and even though they didn't have all of them, because not everybody within the country uses the same routers, wireless routers, most of the routers were actually vulnerable, primarily because firms, companies that produce routers, they use very, very similar firmware on a similar routers, which are designed for similar purposes. For example, for home routers, you will find that the firmware from one router to the other is very similar indeed. And same vulnerabilities usually apply. Anyway, this doesn't of course necessarily need to be true. So they grabbed this huge amount of wireless passwords. Of course, they couldn't use all of them. The idea was that they would manage to grab wireless password keys from wireless access points that were within their range, so within the range of their network, wireless network card. And they did actually manage to pull those as well, except they pulled a lot of others as well. They pulled thousands and thousands of others as well. And of course, they stored that into a file, one huge file, and then they began searching. Searching through the file for ESSIDs of wireless access points around them, if any of them corresponded to the ESSIDs within the file. And of course, they were matches. And once they found those matches, they've had wireless passwords for all of the networks around them, for all of the wireless access points around them, which was great. It was hilarious. It was a complete success, except it was completely illegal. Not sure whether they got caught or not, but they made it into the newspapers or something of a kind, so I assume that they have. Anyway, what we're going to do today is exactly that, but we're not going to do anything illegal. I'm not going to do any mass scanning or anything like that. Whatever I do, I will do within the confines of my own home network. But the principle is the same, really. The only difference is the IP address that you pass. Although I'm definitely not encouraging you to do this. You could get into serious trouble by mass scanning, especially from your home or something of a kind. Make sure to inquire about regulations of your ISP provider, what is permitted and what is not. pretty much all the ISP providers out there will allow scanning, but they have some regulation in regard to that scanning. You either need a permission or you need to say that you will do it, and so on and so forth. So just make sure that you are acquainted with your local ISP provider's rules in regard to the scanning. You don't need to call anybody or anything like that if you are uncomfortable with it. Just go on the net. These sort of things, they're in the public domain, they're public information, so they will give it to you. That's not a problem. They all have these specific rules and they like when people follow them through, so they're public and so on. What I'm trying to tell you is make sure that you're not doing anything illegal here. Anyway, without further ado, let's just go ahead and start having some fun with Nmap. So first of all, I will be exploiting my home wireless router, which is set up for this particular exercise, and I do believe I have a small file here that I've prepared for myself. Yep, there we go. So we have one command down at the bottom, and we have two different file directories, which we're going to use. So anyway, let's go ahead and give it a shot. Before we actually do the scan itself, I want to show you how you can install scripts, because as you can see from this last command, you have R file equals, and then you have a certain, sorry, not R file, you have dash dash script, and then HTTP dash tp-link dash dir dash traversal dot nse. And then you have arguments for that particular script. Anyway, you don't need to actually memorize this long command. If we just go over to the website, the Nmap website, you will see that no matter which script you actually choose at the bottom, well, close to the bottom anyway, you will have example usage. They've done this in such a fantastic way. I mean, you don't even need to think about it that much. You just need to read what the particular script does. Once you do that, you can literally just copy paste this command, and then in addition to that, you can just assign a target or targets, as you will soon see. But before you can actually utilize any of these scripts, you need to know how to install them. And that can be tricky from time to time because there isn't exactly a clean way of doing it like there is, for example, for packages which are in the official repositories that you can pull with Yum. This is a bit more complex, but nothing too hard. So you see, you have at the beginning, it says download, HTTP, //nmap.org, and then scripts. So just go ahead and click on that link, basically. Oops, let's do it like this. So open link in new tab. Excellent, so you have this rather large script here. Go ahead and Control A just to make sure that you have selected everything. Control C to copy it. And, well, okay, so no problems. Where's the, there we go. And now what you need to do is figure out where these scripts are located. I am already in the scripts folder, but if I cd back to root and clear, I have no idea where the Nmap scripts are located. But what do I know? I know that the Nmap script extensions end up with .nse. So let's just go ahead and type in the command locate. What do you think this command does? It says locate. It literally locates the file. But we're going to use a wildcard argument dot and then nsc. What this command means is please locate all files that have an extension of dot nsc. Press enter, and there we go. We have a bunch of them, a lot of them here, but that's really irrelevant. What we have here is a path to where these scripts are located. I'm not going to use a full path. I'm going to zoom in a little bit first and then go ahead and type in cd/usr share and nmap, enter, clear, ls. Excellent. So we are here in this nmap folder and we have scripts over here, but there's also one more thing which you need to pay attention. It says nslib. It's right next to the scripts right here. It's nsclib. And these are the two folders which you will probably need to use extensively. There's also payloads and so on and so forth, and we might do this at a different time, but for the time being, let's just focus on these two and see how these scripts are actually installed. Let's just go ahead and clear the screen, cd into scripts, ls, and there we go. We have a lot of them here. So these scripts are all used to either scan or exploit different types of vulnerabilities, depending on what sort of scripts they are. And the way you would do it is actually, let me just see if I already have this script installed so I don't do it like twice over. Copy. Okay, so ls. This is the way to com this is one of the ways to confirm it. And yes, I actually do. So I can just do cat, and then let's paste it again. Press enter, and there you go. You have the entire script listed here. Pretty much just copy pasting. There we go. It starts from here, and just copy pasting what we saw on the website. So over here, these two files are exactly the same. So just select everything that is here and copy it into the script folder. Clear. So I already have the file. I already have that script here. But in case I didn't, what I would do is type in the following. I would touch. That's a command. I'm not going to touch anything, obviously, aside from my keyboard. Type in touch, and then we would need a name of the file. So you would just do this. Apparently, I have created it. Let me just ls the same thing. Okay, so it's already there, so it can't actually create it, no problems. Anyway, you would actually create it, or you don't even need to use touch. You can just use nano and then paste the name. Remember that the name needs to remain the same, and then I would just paste the code from the website into this particular file, the new file that I would create. So what you need to do is type in nano, name of the new file that you wish to create. This one is full, obviously, but I can delete all of this and copy that from the website. And that would be all that I would need to do. Make sure that the name is exactly as it says on the website. So you can grab the name of the script from here, no problems. Here I can just open link a new tab. I have some vuln scripts here, and let's just pick the first one. So this one would be apf copy. Do I have it here? ls, sorry. Ls paste. Yep, I even have this one. I have a vast majority of these scripts here, so I don't have any problems with that. But you will need to manually install some of them, and I've just showed you how. So just create a file with this name, with the specific name of the script, which you can grab from the site, and then fill that script up with the information that you can find on the download link at the top of the site. So just Control A, Control C, and then you would paste it obviously in the file in the terminal. That is the way to use it. Now down at the bottom, it says requires. So these are some of the things that it requires, and you go down into libraries, Control F, vulns, and there you go. It says vulns. That's one of the libraries required. So let me just go through it. Yep, there we go. Source, copyright, on show, those are functions down below. I'm not interested in that. Anyway, example of permutable host script. The following example illustrates. There is bound to be a link somewhere. To match different vulnerabilities, exploit, ability table. There we go. There we go. Source. Sorry, there is no download section here. It just says source. If you click on it, again, you are given the same screen, which you can just Control A to copy, and no problems there. Same procedure as with the script. You just Control A to copy everything within this. You come back. You actually need to have the same name for this library. And you go ahead and open up your terminal. You go out of the scripts because we don't want to be there. You go ls, where is it? nselib. nselib ls. And you would basically create it here. Make sure that the extension has, well, let's just go ahead and do that. Oh man, this is not what I wanted to create. Give me a second. Give me a second here. So nano, go back to the website, vulns.lua, go back to the terminal, paste. Huh, okay, so I already have this one as well, but if I didn't, I would just paste the code into here and I would press Control O to save it. That is all you need to do. There is nothing else quite literally that you need to do. It's just a bunch of copy-paste action. That is all. A lot of these files and a lot of the scripts you will have by default installed, so don't worry about it. Just in case you need something very specific, you would actually need to go on over to their website, not download it, but just copy-paste the code. That is it. You don't need to do anything else. I just cleared the screen. If you still have some problems with this or something of a kind, feel free to address me in the question sections. In the question section, I will be more than happy to help you out any way I can. Anyway, let's employ this last command, paste, and include this script. So it says here target. My target is going to be 192.168.0.1. And this is my wireless router. Now I am giving it a LAN address, but you can give it a external IP address as well if you have it. I don't have exit onto internet from my wireless router, so I'm using it like this. Press enter, and there we go. We have a VPA VPA passphrase, a wonderful passphrase, seriously, like test 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, the most original one you will ever see. ESSID is somewhere in here as well. Feel free to just go about looking for it. More importantly, VPS default pin is here. Make sure to grab this, because if the user changes the password, you want to know the pin. You'll want to know the pin because you can retrieve that password afterwards, the way I showed you in the where we used Reaver in order to extract the VPA password, passphrase, or passkey with a pin. If you give Reaver the default pin, it's going to pull the password, no problems, immediately. Anyway, I will wrap the tutorial up here. This is one of the ways in which you can get the IP addresses, the VPS2 passwords, passkeys. And aside from the IP address here, you can type in dash I L and then give it a file which contains a list of IP addresses. A file which contains a list of IP addresses will look something like this. So you would have 195. So again, 192.168.1.44.298.1.12, I don't know, 33. So these are the IP ranges which you can put into this file, and then later on you can actually pass them to nmap with an IL command and just type in test. And the nmap will actually take all those IP address ranges and will do exactly the same thing for every single IP address there. In any case, I would like to bid you all farewell, and I'll hope to see you in the next tutorial.